Good morning. Good morning. And as you find your seat, let me encourage you to see that our prelude is one of the many parts of our worship service. The prelude is designed to cause us to stop and prepare ourselves for worship. I encourage you to look in your bulletin and see that our prelude is centered around two rich hymns focusing on the good news of Jesus for us. And I encourage you to follow along because the prelude is designed to quiet our hearts, prepare us to turn our eyes upon Jesus. Let me remind you of one of the stanzas that does just that. Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all, a healing stream flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever. From the cross, my ransomed soul shall live forever.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to 10th Presbyterian Church. We are especially grateful that you're here, and if you are visiting with us, we're also very glad that you're with us and trust that you would know the warmth of Christ as we come to worship Him. There's no higher calling for anyone than to take a day of rest and to come together and worship the Lord God Almighty. If you have your bulletins, you'll need those to continue in our worship as we all stand together and sing the doxology and along with a unified confession of our faith as well. Our call to worship comes from 1 Chronicles, reminding us of indeed why we are here. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Turn in your bulletin and see our confession of sin. When we come into God's presence to worship Him, we must be reminded anew of who He is, who we are, how desperately we need Him, and how willing He is to love and forgive us. So let's join together in unison confessing our sin. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, we confess that we have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts and have offended against your holy laws. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfect me remind you again of a rich promise of God that we are so familiar with, but need to pause again and again to give praise. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Let us pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you for your promises fulfilled in Jesus. So we come now in this hour of worship in his name, asking by your Holy Spirit, you would come upon us. Let us see anew the richness of what we are about to do. We are here to give praise to Almighty God. We are here to hear from our Lord. We are here to be reminded of his rich sacrifice for us. Oh God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, come among us that we would worship and adore you. And we ask this in the precious and mighty name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated if you can. Wasn't that wonderful? Love praise that way. Let's unite our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we come to praise you, to lift your name. Our hearts rejoice at the freedom that we have in this country, indeed in our hearts, to be able to come. Jesus Christ himself has called us to come and to praise you, and so we do. We praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, grateful again that not only are you the Creator, God, but you have indeed provided for us. You have rescued us out of our sin, out of the trap that we found ourselves in. You have brought us forth into life, into the freedom of knowing you, into grace abundant. And as we continue to find new facets of grace in our life, we pray that the praise of our hearts may indeed be a delight in your eyes and in your heart itself. We give you thanks again for being able to call us. We thank you that we can be together as a fellowship, not only to praise, but also to draw deeply upon the friendships that are here at 10th. We give you thanks for those lines of friendship who would go deep into our spiritual lives and pray that we might build upon them. To that end, Lord, we pray that you would bless each of the times that we get together, not only for fellowship, but also as we search out your word, as we learn more of your truth. We pray that that will go down into our souls, that it will make us more like Christ, who we desire to emulate, and that indeed, more and more, our obedience to you may be immediate. Our joy in you may continue to be grounded in the truth that we have in Christ, that we may celebrate day by day forgiveness that we have received in the way that we forgive others, in the grace that we have understood by the way that we are gracious towards others, and that indeed in our lives we may find new ways of praising you, of worshiping you, by putting these truths into place. We pray that the way that we live our lives may be a striking testimony of your grace, of the joy and the satisfaction that we find in you alone. Lord, we give you thanks for our many friends who have partnered with us in this gospel going out into other cultures and countries. We pray for your blessing to be upon them. We pray for our friends who are coming home from Turkey this week. They need to come because Ed's mother is failing in her health. We pray that you give them safety, that they may come safely, that all the provision that they have for a car, as well as the way that you provided a place for them to stay near to her place, might be made available. We pray that you indeed will give them great comfort as they pass that along to this dear saint who is now in her last days. Lord, we pray that true for many others in our congregation who have indeed seen and walked through this time of grief. We pray for your blessing to remain upon them, as we know you will do that. We've just sung about your love continuing on, not only now, but through eternity. Indeed, we call upon that love now that you would give to those who walk through grief, who walk through difficult times, who suffer chronically, and for those who are going through difficult medical situations right now. May we, as a congregation, be aware of them, lift their names up before you, not to be vainly repetitious, but rather to show the solidarity that we have, the joy and love that we share, and our confidence in your love for us. Lord, too, we would give you thanks for those that you have put in government positions over us. We recognize that you've raised them up that they might be able to help with truth and justice in our lives and in this culture. We pray for your blessing to be upon our mayor and the council who govern over us locally. We pray for our governor and all of those who are serving in our state Congress. We pray that you would help them in their decision making, that they might cut through some of the frivolous, that they will begin to work together even more for the good of society. And we would pray too for those who are able to carry out justice as well as law enforcement in our area. For those who put their lives on the line daily, we'd ask that you would be gracious and kind to them and their family. And for those who provide emergency services, Lord, we pray that you would indeed be kind and gracious to them. We would ask very jealously that they may come to know you so that their joy may be fuller in the way that they carry out their tasks on a daily basis. We pray for those who serve in hospitals, for medical personnel who help with our own health and indeed provide sometimes interventive care for us. Lord, we give you thanks for all of these people and different positions that you've put into our lives. But we pray that they may have the joy of knowing how they serve you and the order that you have put into this world as well. Lord, we give you praise and thanks, and we would ask that you would help those in our congregation who are unemployed and who are underemployed, those for whom each day is very difficult, and as sometimes rejection upon rejection of job applications come up, we pray that you would restore their hope because they know that you will help and continue to provide for them. We pray that as a fellowship we may stand well together. For indeed, that is the way you've put us together in the body of Christ. And so, Lord, we give you thanks again for this time of celebration, and especially as we gather around your table, to be reminded again of salvation and these elements for the bread and for the grape juice. We give you thanks and pray once again that you will be glorified in our lives as we live in satisfaction before you. For it is in and through the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Just a few announcements as we have this time. One is to remind you that we have communion this morning, and we've done a new thing. Instead of having little cards out on the pews, we're actually using the welcome cards. So this is a benefit. If you're visiting us, please fill this out. If you're a member or a regular attender, please fill this out, because on the back there's communion attendance. And we want to know who's here so that we also know who's not here and who should be included. We want to take communion to those who are shut in so that they don't feel that they're alone or forgotten or shuffled off into a corner, but rather, that's why we take the attendance, in case you were wondering. People have asked, so I thought I'd emphasize that. Also, I want to give a personal invitation to the newlyweds in our congregation. There is a luncheon today thrown by the newlywed class, and it's going to be over at 1616 Walnut Street. Beautiful building. You should go if you're newly married. And if you want to know how you get there, everyone's going to meet out front, and you can look for Jerry, because he's going to be going. Why? Because he's a newlywed. So you're all welcome. That's going to be right after the service today. Also, if you take your bulletins, yes, please take them. Open them to the exact center fold. You will notice that on here, there's an announcement about this Tuesday night. We are doing our parish-wide prayer meeting times, and we'd love you to be able to join. Prayer is needed, and we need to draw together in fellowship to encourage each other in our prayer. So if you look there at the top, on the left, on the right, you'll see it. It's up here. You'll find the locations of where each of the parishes are meeting. If you don't know what area you live in, just choose the one closest to you and go to it, okay? But I hope that you'll make that priority on Tuesday night. Thank you.
pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that we have the joy of giving because you have given to us. We ask that this act of giving would be a work of your Spirit as well, that we would see we are returning to you what you have blessed us with, a portion that you will multiply for your glory and honor. Lord, use that these monies for your glory here at 10th and around the world, that Jesus Christ would be praised, for we ask in his name. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, let's take our Bibles this morning and turn together to the book of Hebrews, to chapter 7. That's on page 1004, if you're using the church Bible that you'll find in the rack in front of you. Hebrews chapter 7. We're breaking into an argument or a discussion about a figure from the remote past of antiquity, And this figure is tied to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can see that if you look at the end of chapter 6, which gives it context. The writer says, and here is the word of God, "We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that comes or that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." So that's the context. And in verse 11, he says this, "Now if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need would there have been for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek rather than one named after the order of Aaron? For when there is a change in the priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. For the one of whom these things are spoken belonged to another tribe, from which no one has ever served at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord was descended from Judah, and in connection with that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. This becomes even more evident when another priest arises in the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become a priest not on the basis of a legal requirement concerning bodily descent, but by the power of an indestructible life. For it is witnessed of him," quote, "you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek," close quotes. "For on the one hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God." It is hard for us sitting here in this room this morning to grasp the tectonic shift that had to take place in the thinking and in the lives of these first century Jews when they encountered the risen Jesus. As one Jewish girl was honest enough to say in a class that I was teaching at King's College in London, "Jesus is the Messiah we weren't looking for and the Messiah we didn't want." Because the arrival of Jesus on the scene broke all categories, challenged all traditions, overturned all assumptions of what it meant to be the Messiah of Israel. And one of the ways in which this viewing of the Messiah changed was in the connection between Jesus, not only as a king, that was expected, but as a priest. So the author, for example, has said in chapter 5, verse 11, he said that Jesus Christ is our great high priest. And he tells the people that he's got a lot to say about him, as we are beginning to discover. Back in chapter 5, we didn't know that, but now we're learning that he has a lot to say about this man, Melchizedek. He says this, "About this we have much to say, and it is hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing." So he actually puts the blame on them. So it is hard to explain Melchizedek. Anybody who's ever studied it will know that for themselves, read it for themselves. If you've been trying to lead a small group study of Hebrews, you'll know that this is the part you can skip. Or if you've ever preached on it or had the nightmare of having it preached to you, you will understand that it is hard to explain. And the author gives me the great ability to bat it back on you and say, because you're dull of hearing. Well, that's what he said about his audience. His audience were a Jewish Christian audience. And the things that he was saying were challenging their Jewish background, their Jewish roots. Now, the whole section that we've just read, verses 11 to 19, are bracketed by the use of a word that occurs in verse 11 and verse 19, the word perfect or perfection. And that really opens up this little section to us, the word perfect or perfection. Because it's possible to consider the word perfection absolutely or relatively. Absolutely, perfection relates to the glory that is to come when humanity, human beings, believers are brought into their highest state. This is the way the Apostle Paul uses it when he's writing to the Philippians. And he says this, that he says to them, you know, I haven't attained perfection yet. Here are his words. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. And by perfection there, he means the totality of that which Christ has procured, obtained, purchased for the believer. The totality of what he has purchased for the believer. And that totality isn't complete yet. Not in the absolute sense. In that passage in Philippians, the apostle links it to the resurrection of the dead. In Hebrews chapter 12, the writer to the Hebrews links it with those who have already entered into the glory of God in the heavenly Jerusalem. He talks there about the spirits of just men and women made perfect. And at the end of 1 Corinthians 13, the apostle refers to that future time when the perfect has come. So in its absolute sense, the perfection belongs to the life of glory, which is a Christian way of talking about people in the immediate presence of God. Sin-free, death-free, life in the presence of God, after death and in the new heavens and the new earth. But the word perfection can also be used relatively of this gospel age in which we live, this good news age in which we live. This initial state that the believer finds themselves in can be called relatively a state of perfection. Not that you're perfect, but this gospel that we have received, this message that we have heard, is a completed message. The good news that it proclaims to people, the work of Christ, is a completed, accomplished, and perfected work. The salvation that is offered to you this morning is not half a salvation, or quarter of a salvation, or three quarters of a salvation, or nine-tenths of a salvation, but a perfect salvation that you may enjoy right now. Right now, today, you may enjoy the salvation that's offered in the gospel. The Lord Jesus Christ is the founder and perfecter of our faith. Well, it's with this in mind then that the writer here in these verses we read from 11 to 19 picks up this notion of perfection, and he says that we have a snapshot of perfection. We have a snapshot of perfection right at the very beginning of the Bible. That's what he's been arguing. That's where this man Melchizedek comes into view. Melchizedek is a human figure. He met Abraham, who's the father of the Semite people. Abram, who is the promise, the one to whom all the promises of God, both for Israel and for the church, were given. And this man Melchizedek makes this brief appearance. You can read it for yourself in Genesis chapter 16. The Holy Spirit only describes what he needs to describe to make Melchizedek look like the Son of God. Melchizedek is a king and a priest. Melchizedek is characterized by righteousness and peace. Melchizedek has no beginning and no ending. Now, the historical figure, of course, the historical figure did have a beginning. He was born, and he did have an ending. He died. But in the structure and in the narrative of Genesis, inspired by the Holy Spirit has left off, has left out of the story what is important in absolutely every other story in the book of Genesis, which is the book of genealogies. He does not record this man's beginning or ending for a reason. And we don't know that reason until 1,000 years after he lived, when King David, who was a prophet, refers back to the story of Melchizedek in a psalm in which he is talking about the Lord of glory who becomes the Messiah King of Israel. And he says that this one, this coming Messiah, who is the Lord of glory, is a priest, a king and a priest, according to the order of Melchizedek. So in Melchizedek, we have a snapshot of what perfection, the perfection of the gospel age looks like, centered around a king priest, characterized by righteousness and peace. He has no beginning and no ending, the Son of God. He's eternal, everlasting, and he's everlastingly for his people. He blesses his people everlastingly. So we have a snapshot of perfection when we look at the name Melchizedek. But then secondly, the author describes a failure of perfection. And here he focuses in on something that happened halfway between Melchizedek's life and King David's life, about 500 years after Melchizedek lived, and about 500 years before David lived, Moses, the great prophet of Israel, lived. And after Israel was brought out of its slavery and bondage in Egypt, you will know that Moses was a prince of Egypt. You know that from the cartoon, from nowhere else. But he was a historical figure, and he was a Jew, and he led the people out of their slavery, and he led them into the desert. And they wandered around that desert for 40 years. And while they're wandering around that desert, God appeared to them in a mountain, from a mountain. They saw the spectacular sights and sounds. They heard the voice of God addressing Moses. There were angels there, part of the whole package. It was an awe-inspiring memory, engraving experience that never left the children of Israel. And in that experience, God gave the people his law. There was his moral law, written by on people's before in people's consciousness. It was now written down, and that law demonstrated, the Ten Commandments demonstrated, how severely damaged people are in their relationship with God. The law is a very negative thing. Thou shalt not. The law tells you where you've gone wrong. The law, it tells you you're going too fast. I know that from personal experience. The law tells you the boundaries of acceptable behavior and acceptable living. The law is negative. And when a man or a woman leads the law of God, a man or a woman cannot come away from the law of God, if they have any sensitivity in their conscience at all, without denying it, putting it somewhere where they don't think about it anymore, or feeling the weight of that law heavy upon their conscience. Telling them, screaming at them sometimes, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The moral law breaks you. The moral law cuts you to pieces. The moral law of God kills you. It does not make you alive. God gives them the moral law. But he gave them something else. He gave them the ceremonial law. And the ceremonial law was given to help people who've seen that they are sinners, who know that they're far away from God but want to come closer to him, a way in which they can have their sins forgiven and have a closer relationship with God. And essential to that ceremonial law was the appointment of a priesthood. Now, let me put it like this. The priesthood were appointed specifically to represent the people of God. Here's how it began. The Lord God of Israel had said to them, the people, the Israelites, that all the firstborn of Israel, all the firstborn of Israel are mine. That's what God said. I can take them and use them in whatever way I want. They belong to me. And they would remember that when they were in Egypt, it was the firstborn in all the families of Egypt, including their own, that would have died unless a lamb had died in their place. All the firstborn of Israel are mine. Numbers chapter 12, chapter 3, verse 13. And then God says to Israel, I have taken the Levites, the tribe of Levi. So there's Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There's Jacob's sons. There are the 12 tribes. Levi is one of those tribes. His father was Aaron, who's mentioned in the text there at the end of verse 11. Levi, God says, I have taken the Levites from among the people of Israel instead of, in the place of, as a substitute for, and as representatives of every firstborn in Israel. So what I want you to do for a moment there is just get process that just for a little minute. What is that telling you about the role of the priest? The role of the priest is to represent you. More specifically, the role of the priest is to represent you before God. And you say, well, the world of priests and temples and sacrifices is so distantly removed from my experience Monday to Saturday, Liam, you're going to have to help me a bit more. Well, you imagine there is an industrial dispute and you bring in the arbitration people. They come in and they get everybody together and their job is to negotiate between the offending and offended parties and so on. Well, that's a bit what a priest does. A priest is a mediator. A priest is a mediator between man and God. In fact, earlier on in Hebrews, a priest acts for people in relation to God. Now, here's what the law said. The law said, the soul that sins dies. The law said, the wages of sin is death. God institutes the priesthood and the sacrificial system so that when people read the law of God, when they look into that perfect law and they see the imperfections of themselves in that law as it points out the defects in them, what do those people do with that? Despair? Die of despair? They go to their priest and they take a sacrifice of their poor turtle dove or two pigeons, just as Mary and Joseph did when their baby was born and they were poor people. Or an animal that you have, a lamb or whatever, you take that to the priest. The priest kills the animal. It dies instead of you dying. And the priest offers it to God. The priest acts for you in relation to God with a view to mending the broken relationship between you and God. That was the job of the Levites. But their job never ended. Their job went on and on and on because sin goes on and on and on. The sacrifice sinned. Yesterday you offered a sacrifice. You sin today, you're going to have to offer a sacrifice. You sin tomorrow, you have to offer a sacrifice. You sin 10 years from now, you have to offer a sacrifice. It goes on and on and on. And this is precisely the argument that the author is making here. If perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, if it was possible to have perfection by that regime, then why in the middle of the Bible, from the lips of King David, no less, a prophet of God as well as a king, do we have this promise that God is going to institute another priest from the order of Melchizedek? You see, the reality is that all of the sacrifices and ceremonies of Israel appeased the conscience for a while. They dealt with sin in a transitional way, but not in a final way. As F.F. Bruce puts it, the whole apparatus of the worship associated with sacrifice, ritual, and priesthood was calculated rather to keep a people at a distance from God than to bring them near. You would go, perhaps, on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. You would climb the hill of the Lord towards the temple. If you were a Gentile, you'd get so far and then you'd reach this wall that said, "No trespassing. No Gentiles welcome beyond this point." So you'd stand there. You'd be able to see over the heads of the crowd the elevated temple. You'd see the open doors. You'd look inside and you would see at the very back of the temple this great curtain with its gold and blue and purple and beautiful, catching a glimpse of the sun on it, magnificent. And you would know that that was an obstacle. Nobody, not you, not the Jews on the other side of the wall, nor the priests operating in the outer courts of the temple, none of you could go behind that curtain into the inner place, into the Holy of Holies. You were barred. So though you had a way of finding initial and transitional pardon for your sin, your access to God was limited by the very apparatus of Israelite worship, by the very architecture of the temple or tabernacle. Only once a year, on the Day of Atonement, did the high priest take an offering and go behind that screen. Once a year, with the names of the tribes of Israel embossed on the breastplate of his gear that he was wearing. Of the names of Israel on his shoulder pads. They must have been big shoulder pads. Dynasty or something. Names of Israel embossed on his shoulder because he was going in there as the representative of all of Israel, representing them, carrying them in his heart as beloved and on his shoulder to bear their burden into the presence of God. And all of the machinery of worship would leave you excluded from that place. So the text moves on. And it tells us of a promise of perfection. If that system worked up to a degree, but the repetitiousness of it and the fact of the exclusion of the worshiper from the inner sanctuary where God met with people left you at a distance from God, we need something else. That's what the author is arguing for here. He argues that there has been given to us this promise of perfection. It was given, as I've said earlier, by David, a psalmist, and also a prophet. In Psalm 110, where David is describing very mysteriously, and we'll look at this another time, but very mysteriously, in the Greek it says, "The Lord," the name for the one and only God, "said to my Lord," the name for the one and only God. Yahweh says to Adonai. Adonai is the name for the God of Israel. Yahweh is the name for the God of Israel. It's a conundrum. Jesus challenged the people in his own day about it. He said, "What do you think was going on there? The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand." Who sits at the right hand of God? Who has the same power as God, the same majesty of God as God, the same glory as God? There was this mystery written by David, of all people. Didn't make any sense until the Son of God came into the world. But it was in that psalm that David reports the Lord saying to the Lord, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." So think of that snapshot of perfection there in the middle of Genesis 14. Comes and goes, three verses, that's all. A snapshot of perfection. Someone who is a priest and a king. That was forbidden in Israel. A priest and a king. Characterized by righteousness and peace. Having no beginning and no ending. Here is David saying, there is one who is Lord. One who is the Lord of glory. And he has been appointed to be a priest after the order of Melchizedek. In other words, for you to understand who he is, think about what you've just thought about that figure, Melchizedek, back there in Genesis 14. So this is a promise of perfection. That's what the author says here. If perfection was attainable through the Levitical priesthood, what further need would there have been for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek? This pointed to Christ. You see, when it talks there about the law, look at verse 12. When there is a change in priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. The Levitical priesthood had laws for how they did their work. And the whole ceremony of the temple, the whole ceremony of the sacrificial system was all part of their job description. And they had to do what they were supposed to do to the letter of the law. But there's a new priesthood. There's this one priest whom the writer has called our great high priest. He's in the order of Melchizedek. Different from these other ones. And there's a new law concerning him. There's been a change in priesthood. That's the language that's used here. This is what the writer to the Hebrews has already mentioned. For example, what did this promise in Psalm 110 involve? It involved the Lord becoming human. Because his big argument in chapters 2 and 3 was, in order to be a priest, you had to be human. You had to have a fellow feeling with the people you were dealing with. You had to belong to the same stuff, the same human stuff, as the human people that you were representing to God. You couldn't be a priest, far less a high priest, if you weren't human. You couldn't be from Mars and be priest. You couldn't be an angel and be the priest. So he said in chapter 2, verse 17, for this reason he had to be made like his brothers and sisters in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. So that brings us, therefore, to what he has to say about this Jesus. He says about Jesus, he was descended from David, not Levi. He came in a different tribe. He came from the royal tribe of Judah. Going back to the end of Genesis, the scepter, the sign of royal authority, will not depart from Judah. Time of David. God promises David one of his offspring would have an everlasting kingdom. The prophets foretold there would be a branch come from the root of David that would be the Messiah. And Jesus was born, son of Abraham, son of David. We need a human being to be our priest. But you notice what he says in verse 16. Another priest arises in the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become a priest not on the basis of a legal requirement concerning bodily descent. That's a reference to the house of Levi. They were the only people who acted as priests. But by the power of an indestructible life. Now in the Greek, there are two references here to according to. There is this new priest has been raised up according to the order of Melchizedek to be like him. And secondly, according to the power of an indestructible life. And it's that last phrase there that refers to the basis of Jesus' priesthood, his resurrection and his exaltation to God's own life, that is, in his humanity, to God's own life, which never ends. And there are a series of phrases here that balance each other, and very skillfully so in the original Greek. There's the law balanced by power. There's the commandment balanced by the word life. There's the word fleshly in the sense of entirely human with the word indestructible. And so he's contrasting the old priesthood and the priesthood of Christ. He says one is about the law, external norms. Do this, do that, do the next thing. This other, Christ's, is marked by power, the dynamic, the energy, the capacity, the ability to do what God wants you to do. One is marked by the commandment, that is, your obedience. The other is marked by life. The Son has life in himself. The Son is resurrection and life. The Son has all the life of God because he is God. He has life and therefore is able to give you life, able to give you eternal life, able to transform your physical reality and make it eternal, the life of God. He has life. And then there's the merely human. That's his argument here, that the old priesthood was based on a merely human genealogy. You had to be born a Levite to be a priest. But this new king, this new priest, is marked by indestructibility. He lives in the power of an indestructible life. That is the life of God. God alone is indestructible. And the Lord Jesus Christ is our priest because he is able to give life out of the life of God. So what the law does is pile on regulations. What the Son does is he generates and regenerates and regenerates life in you and I. He gives us life, gives us power, gives us the ability to live for him. So that old ancient king Melchizedek appears to have, in the picture, as a snapshot of perfection. He appears always to have lived. In that he is made like the Son of God, and by virtue of his resurrection, the Lord Jesus lives and has been hyper-exalted in his humanity to the eternal throne of God. He has eternal existence as God. The old regime is marked by vulnerability. The new regime offers us hope. Look at that. Look at the vulnerability. Verse 18, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness. It could not do something. What could it not do? It could not get you behind that curtain into the innermost presence of God. It could not give you intimacy with God. But what is the new thing done? We have a better hope through which we draw near to God. What is that better hope? Remember where we started. We started looking at the end of chapter 6. We have this sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain. How do we get there? Where Jesus has gone. What was the role of a priest again? To represent me. Where is he gone? He's gone behind the curtain. Where am I? Left with the crowd behind the wall, looking at the curtain in the distance. When he died on the cross, that curtain was torn. And I'm there with him because I'm in Christ. He's gone there, as it were, with all his people dangling from his belt. They're there with him in the presence of God. And what that means, we can spell it out just very briefly this morning, is this. It means that in this gospel age of relative perfection for us, there is righteousness for us. If sin made the law weak, we have discovered that in Jehovah Jesus, we have righteousness and strength, and we are justified and we glory. In our King Priest, we have peace. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who made peace by offering himself as the sacrifice and preached peace to us. We have light. Whereas up until Christ came, there was some understanding and some insight. The full blaze of what God was doing throughout all of his interactions with people in history have come to their perfection in the Lord Jesus Christ. Completeness in him. And we have boldness. We don't stand from a distance looking at the curtain. The curtain is gone, and we come boldly. Forgetting everything in the way, we come boldly to the throne of grace. We come boldly to God as his children, adopted into his family. And because Jesus is our entry into the very presence of God. And we have hope. We've been brought into the light, and we've seen that Christ is there, and that where he is, we will be also. He is our forerunner. That means we're going as well. He's gone on our behalf there, and we follow him. And joy, joy, because there's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Joy because we don't have to worry about it not working. It works. The resurrection of Jesus proves that. That glory is ours. And it leaves us with a spirit of confidence. Confidence in God. Confidence in our Lord Jesus Christ. Confident in being able to boast and praise and rejoice not in our worth, not in our merit, not in our works, but in our perfect Savior, and that perfect salvation, and that perfect life that has begun now for my soul and will be perfected for my body on the day of resurrection in the new heavens and the new earth. Isn't that a great good news? Is this something you share? Do you share it because you trust in him whom we trust in? And rely on him whom we rely upon, this Jesus. This one who's been introduced to us, through whom we draw near to God. Father, we pray this morning that you would give to your people that real joy and confidence in all that you have accomplished for them in our Lord Jesus Christ. You fill us with joy and peace in believing. And as we come to take the bread and wine, may these be to us the tangible, visible, obvious demonstrations of the promises that you've made. And may you feed us, Lord, with bread from heaven. Cleanse us with that wine of your love and cleansing in our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Do please sit down. I want to welcome all of you who know and love the Lord Jesus, who know yourself this morning, to stand as you've been doing with us at the foot of the cross, knowing that your sins have been pardoned, and all because of what our Lord Jesus has done for us. So if you're a believer baptized into the fellowship of Christ Church, we welcome you at the table this morning. The Apostle Paul writes, "For I receive from the Lord that which I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'"
Ephesians 2. "In Christ, you who once were far off have been brought near to the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace."
The bread of heaven is life for the world. Let's eat with thanksgiving. In the same way, our Lord took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
First Peter 2, Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls.
The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Let's drink with thanksgiving. And let's together proclaim the mystery of our religion. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is come again. Thanks be to God. We're going to sing the next hymn. We'll remain seated and then stand for the closing verse while the offering for the Deacon's Fund is taken up. And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.